It's a journey. It's a journey. It's a journey. Bootleg enlightenment I found in your snakeskin suitcase. Go round. She wants more. I'm overboard now. Baby, drown, drown, drown. It's a journey. It's a journey. It's a journey. Outside they wait, bats upside down. Vampires selling sunscreen to clowns. And I'm the one with red nose. Now watch these metal horses go round. She waits for me in a mine.
In alchemy, they have a term, circulatio, which means to descend to the depths as far as you can go and drink from those deep waters and learn the knowledge in the darkness, and then to ascend as high as you can go to feel the elevation and the spirit of ascension, and take in from that as much light as you can. And life is made not of simply ascending, but actually descending in order to follow it by ascending. And the nature of life, and especially the nature of the soul, is never direct, and it's never simply still. It's always following the course of life, which is like a river that bends and turns and eddies and then flows and touches the rocks, but also accepts the feet of the ducks and everything as it goes along the way. And so there are old teachings that say we are here to go as deep as we can go, to rise as high as we can go, and to inhabit the spaces in between with as much grace and as much creativity and as much humility as we can. The Irish poet William Butler Yeats said, "Now I have to go out and walk amongst the dogs and the horses that understand my talk." And so sometimes for me, the move is not to go into the mainstream, but to head right into the deep waters. I'll go from working on mythology to swimming in salt water. That works well for me. Sometimes it has to go that way. There has to be a medium, an intermediary medium that allows me to decompress or to shift. Otherwise, I find myself in a supermarket, you know, stunned by my incapacity to understand what's going on. And because I've been so much in the other world that I've lost the capacity to navigate in the daily world. And so both are necessary. And then I think a person has to find their own transitional practices. And in the modern world, I think it's harder or more difficult because the daily world is so far dislocated from the other world, dislocated from the imaginal world, the creative world, that separation has become so great that a person who is creative, is an artist or working on their own creativity in some fashion, can find themselves at a greater distance from daily life than I think ancient people were. And so that's a bigger problem than it used to be, near as I can tell. And so a person needs to navigate. And then the idea appears that maybe I'm borrowing here from Carl Jung, that we need friends of the self. That is to say, people who recognize us in our strange capacities and vacancies that can relate to us no matter what state we're in. But to expect to go from being in the depths or the heights of creativity and re-enter the daily world in this world at this time can give you the bends in a real extreme way. Okay, so two things. I want to go back to the separation between worlds. And so living up here in the Northwest, the Native people who do really still do very powerful rituals that are transcendent, and they live near the ocean or the sound, near the bodies of great salt water, which was the origin of life according to myths and according to science. So after a ritual, when everyone is transported and transfigured, they know they can't handle daily life and they go into the sea and they drink the salt water until they throw up. And that's the method for coming back down to earth, or coming back into your body, or coming back into the vulnerability of being human. And so there's a practice that is brilliant, and it really shows that something is needed, almost a regurgitation, a turning the inside out, or throwing back out what has been taken in order to become a regular person again.